In this video, we will talk about two of the most spectacular categories of astrophysical objects. What are magnetars and quasars? Magnetars are neutron stars with a very strong magnetic field. Magnetar is in fact the contraction of magnetic stars. But how are neutron stars formed? And why do some of them become magnetars? When a star exits the main sequence phase, that is the stability phase during which the combustion of hydrogen, which converts it into helium, takes place in the stellar core, it passes through the red giant phase, during which its diameter increases a lot. The subsequent evolution depends on the mass of the star. In the case of the most massive stars, that is with a mass equal to at least 3 times the solar mass, a gravitational collapse of the outermost layers on the core occurs. This occurs because the condition of hydrostatic equilibrium between gravitational force and pressure of radiation generated by thermonuclear reactions, which instead characterize the main sequence phase, is broken. The fall of the outer stellar envelope on the core causes its temperature to rise even up to 100 million degrees in a relatively short time, thus triggering an aftermath of thermonuclear reactions in which the explosive burning of carbon and oxygen takes place. This causes a supernova explosion, in which the stellar envelope is violently ejected from the star and later forms a supernova remnant, such as the Crab Nebula M1, observable in the constellation of Taurus. What remains of the stellar core instead forms a neutron star, a very dense object, so dense that a region with a diameter of about 20 kilometers, roughly the size of a city like New York, would enclose a mass greater than that of the Sun, which, remember, alone contains more than 99% of the mass of the entire solar system. Or using another comparison, the density inside a neutron star is such that a sugar cube would have a mass equal to that of all humanity. Imagine what would happen if a sugar cube containing such a gigantic mass fell on your foot. At these densities, the pressure inside the star is such that the matter collapses even at the atomic level. The electrons, which under normal conditions form a cloud around the nuclei of atoms, formed by protons and neutrons, come to merge with them forming neutrons, hence the name neutron star. A magnetar is a particular type of neutron star that has an enormous magnetic field, from 10 to the power of 13 to 10 to the power of 15 Gauss, billions of times more intense than that of the Earth, whose decay generates intense and abundant electromagnetic emissions. The emission of magnetars can be differentiated into 3 types. Long emission in the X, which lasts for years, then there may be reclusive flares that last for a few fractions of a second, and then there are giant flares, also lasting fractions of a second, but with much higher energies. In addition, gamma rays, and very rarely, radio frequencies are also emitted. About 1 in 10 supernovae are believed to degenerate into a magnetar rather than a more common neutron star or pulsar. It happens when the star already has a fast spin and strong magnetism. It is believed that the magnetic field of a magnetar is the result of a convective motion with a dynamo effect of hot material in the nucleus of the neutron star that occurs in the first 10 seconds or so of the star's life. If the star itself initially rotates at the same speed as the convection period, about 10 ms, the convection currents are able to operate globally on the star and transfer a significant amount of their kinetic energy into the strength of their magnetic field. In less rapidly spinning neutron stars, convective cells form only in certain regions of the star. In the outer layers of the magnetar, the tensions that arise from the torsion of the lines of force of the stellar magnetic field can cause a star quake. That is, the crust of the neutron star is split by the intense magnetism and sinks into the inner layer, very similar to what happens to the Earth's crust during an earthquake. These seismic waves are extremely energetic and cause a strong emission of X and gamma rays. Astronomers call this soft gamma repeater. The active life of a magnetar is quite short. The strong magnetic fields decay after about 10,000 years, after which both the activity and the emission of X-rays cease. To date, about 30 magnetars are known. Be sure to join the channel, leave us a like, and click on the bell. You will help us to make products of even higher quality. Now let's talk about quasars. They are extremely bright, active galactic nuclei. The word quasar derives from the contraction of quasi-stellar radio source. The name derives from the fact that these objects, whose nature was controversial until the early 1980s, were initially discovered as powerful radio sources, whose optical counterpart was as point-like as a star. It is commonly believed that this great luminosity originates from the friction caused by gas and dust falling into a supermassive black hole. They form an accretion disk, which converts about half the mass of an object into energy. The term quasar was coined 56 years ago, in 1964, by the astrophysicist Hongyi Chu. Quasars are among the most mysterious and fascinating celestial objects known. These are very distant galaxies, the furthest known to us, which emit an enormous amount of energy from the nuclear region. Quasars have been known for a few decades, and their discovery, as often happens in astronomy, was accidental. They appear to the telescope as luminous dots with a stellar aspect. However, their spectrum shows different characteristics from the stars. The spectral lines are significantly shifted towards the red. This is due to the fact that they are extragalactic objects billions of light years away, therefore subject to a very high red shift. If you had a spaceship, would you like to reach a quasar to discover how it works? Due to their distance, the optical luminosity of the quasars is very low. In fact, it decreases in proportion to the square of the distance from the source. Most of the radiation emitted by quasars is part of the radio and infrared bands, unlike normal galaxies, which emit mainly in the optic. These objects were initially identified based on their radio emission. In the 1950s, the first radio astronomers had cataloged many radio sources of an unknown nature at the time. However, the resolving power of the radio telescopes at the time was very poor, and did not allow to accurately determine the position of the radio sources, and therefore to establish what type of source it was. In the early 1960s, the new radio telescopes made it possible to obtain the exact position of some of these radio sources. Once the position was known, the optical counterpart of these sources could be studied. A part of them were then identified with nebulae, supernova remnants, or radio galaxies. In 1960, it was discovered that 3C48, an object in the catalog of radio sources, corresponded in the optic to a very faint blue object with a stellar appearance. Its spectrum was also unusual, rich in emission lines. Later, other radio sources of this type were discovered, but it was thought that they were simply peculiar stars with radio emission. Their spectral lines did not resemble any known lines. Subsequently, other compact radio sources were identified with objects of stellar appearance, and this category of stars was called precisely quasar. The extragalactic nature of quasars was only discovered in 1963 by the astronomer Martin Schmidt. He noticed that the spectral lines emitted by the radio source 3C273 had wavelengths spaced in the same way as the lines of hydrogen. However, instead of in the optical band, they were much more red-shifted. Assuming that this red shift was due to the Doppler effect, this meant that 3C273 was moving away from us at 48,000 kilometers per second. A speed too high for a star. It must have been a source outside our galaxy, and also very far. After this discovery, other radio sources and quasars were examined, and for all the verdict was the same. They were extragalactic objects, billions of light years away. By calculating on the basis of distance and apparent brightness, their intrinsic brightness, it was discovered that these objects radiate with enormous power, equal to hundreds of times that of the brightest galaxies. Studying the luminosity of quasars, it was also discovered that it increases and decreases, sometimes almost periodically, with a scale of a few days or weeks. These variations indicate that the source of this enormous luminosity must be very small, a few light days. This is because the speed of light is the maximum speed at which information can propagate. If the dimensions of the source were greater than the distance traveled by the light in a given time interval, its parts could not exchange information, i.e. interact on that time scale, but would be uncorrelated from each other. In this way, those variations in brightness could not be produced. Studying quasars with more powerful instruments, a very weak emission surrounding the compact sources was discovered. These are the optical counterparts of the quasar, which have been identified as galaxies. The nature of quasars was then partly revealed. They are very distant galaxies with very small and powerful active nuclei. They are barely visible due to their enormous distance. But what is the central engine of quasars? Certainly not the nuclear reactions that take place inside the stars. Even adding the contribution of all the stars of a galaxy, one would not obtain a power comparable to that of a quasar, and above all, not concentrated in such a small region. Such objects are thought to be powered, such as the Seyfert galaxies and radio galaxies, by a giant black hole located in the galaxy's core. Around it, there would be an accretion disk of gas and stars in rapid rotation around its axis. From the disk, matter would continually fall on the black hole, producing radiation with enormous power. It would be enough for the black hole to increase a mass slightly higher than that of the Sun every year to explain the observed brightness. One of the most important reasons that push astrophysicists to study quasars lies in their enormous distance. The most distant quasars are located 13 billion light years away and more. It is wonderful, isn't it? Since the speed of light is finite, this also means that the radiation of the quasars we observe today was emitted billions of years ago. These objects appeared to us as they were in the first billions of years of life of the universe, for which can offer astronomers information on the early stages of the universe and the evolution of galaxies. It is not clear, however, whether all galaxies have gone through a phase of this type in their lifetime, or whether they are in any case peculiar objects. But despite the brightness, due to the great distance from Earth, no quasar can be seen with the naked eye. To date, the farthest known quasar is J0313-1806. Its redshift, equal to about 7.64, corresponds to a distance from Earth of over 13 billion light years. The universe was then just under 700 million years old. To find it and measure its distance in a very precise way, an international team of astronomers who made use of the incredible and now indispensable potentialities of the Atacama Large Millimeter Submillimeter Array, ALMA, in Chile, the Magellan-Bata telescope of 6.5 meters, the Gemini North and WM telescope Keck in Hawaii, and finally the Gemini South telescope in Chile. The new discovery breaks the previous distance record set 3 years ago for an object of the same class, and the scientists presented their findings at a meeting of the American Astronomical Society, and in an article accepted for publication by Astrophysical Journal Letters. To make it visible to explorers of the cosmos, its supermassive central black hole, over 1.6 billion times more massive than the Sun and over 1,000 times brighter than the entire Milky Way. Be sure to join the channel, leave us a like, and click on the bell. You will help us to make products of even higher quality.